The goal is to move the needle on heart failure. If a patient is feeling unwell, we can see them in the moment. And that's how I think we're going to change patients' lives. You know, heart failure truly is an epidemic. And heart failure is the inability of the heart to pump adequately to meet the needs of the body. And it is, in many ways, it's the final common denominator for many different cardiac illnesses. So you have many people out there who have conditions that put them at risk. And then we have a large population who have heart failure.
So on the Transform Heart Failure website, there's a phrase, equitable care anytime, anywhere, powered by technology. What does that mean to you in terms of how you're trying to advance the vision of this initiative and also reach different communities?
Well, we know that there's incredible inequities in care. And there are many drivers of those inequities, things related to, for example, the digital divide, access to technology, access to broadband, digital health literacy, skin tone, which can impact the function of various wearables. We have to elevate the care for everybody. It should not matter where you live in Canada. Everybody should have the right to access to high quality care. So one of the things we believe is that technology may be a real tool to enable it.
Can you get into a little bit of how you're bringing heart health resources to Indigenous communities?
So we have been working with the Winnebago Area Health Authority, which is a series of Cree communities that go from Moose Factory all the way up to Piawanak, and went up and visited pre-COVID and talked about some of the challenges. And of course, when you're in community, you have a much better idea of what some of the challenges are. There's power issues that you have to think about. And so when you're thinking about how the technology works, all of these pieces come into play. Otherwise, something that's been, fixed and sorted here may be entirely irrelevant there. Healthcare is still what we're delivering, but technology is a tool that can really allow us to do a better job of that.
So Amika, tell me, how critical are digital health tools for helping people deal with health failure challenges?
I mean, I think it's critical, especially now in the pandemic when we're increasingly accessing healthcare from home. If we think about the experiences of people living with heart failure, they often have other health challenges that they're dealing with, and heart failure in itself is a really complex, challenging condition to cope with.
So you told me that you've been working on a digital health tool for about 4 years now. Can you explain what Medley is?
What Medley is it's an app that supports patients as they're at home to input metrics that are related to their health on a daily basis. So things like their weight, their blood pressure, some of the symptoms that they're experiencing. And what they're able to do then is send those measurements to their clinical care team on a daily basis. And the clinicians can then monitor it on a clinician dashboard to be able to see how their patients are doing and if there's any alerts that they need to be taking into consideration.
So you did your master's in addictions and mental health, and you also are doing your PhD in health informatics. How are you able to bring a unique perspective to this project?
I spent some time in the community working for different nonprofits and really witnessed the gaps in mental health care and the, our ability to access support on any given day. So I really became fascinated with how technology could perhaps facilitate connections and actually allow us to deliver mental health care in a more efficient way. A population health approach really encourages us to appreciate the full spectrum of health, from prevention to illness and treatment, but it also then necessitates us to act at various levels in order to support everyone's mental health. The technology itself gives us new ways to deliver care. It also gives us more information that we can feed back into and learn from, and so we have this really interesting cycle of improving care and also learning from it and being able to then further improve it as a result of delivering care as well.
According to the Heart and Stroke Foundation, one person dies every 5 minutes due to a heart condition, stroke, or a vascular cognitive impairment. So why are wearables such a game changer in fighting heart disease?
Wearables are a game changer because they give access to information that would otherwise be lost. So our lab develops and designs the printed circuit boards that we use in all of these devices. Once we create the printed circuit board, we then encapsulate it in these types of flexible, stretchable silicones. And this allows us to then hermetically seal them and make them robust in order to deploy them on patients. So we have a range of devices that all try to target different aspects of heart failure. And one of the, I think, more advanced metrics that we're moving to is how these sensors communicate and network with each other.
Some people with darker skin tones don't always get accurate readings when they're wearing wearables. How's your research trying to solve this challenge?
Yeah, it actually depends on what type of metric we're looking at. So for heart rate, we actually find that most wearables do quite well, but when it comes to more advanced parameters like blood oxygenation, that's where they have been found to be very lacking. And actually it's been reported that people with higher melanin have been underreported for hypoxia and other types of critical states. So what we're trying to do to address this is by incorporating more wavelengths of light and come up with a more robust calibration method that takes into account melanin at that point of measurement. By raising the bar in terms of how we recruit our population of our trial, we can make sure that these devices work on a broader population of people.
Why is it so important to take a multidisciplinary approach to solving heart disease?
I think it's simply because the problem is so complicated. It requires innate knowledge of the device engineering in order to create the solutions to help these patients, but also requires the on-the-ground knowledge of what these patients need and what they're going through. These diseases are a combination of chronic, long-term management, but also very acute events such as heart attack or stroke. And so by getting more data, we can see how the disease progresses. And one of my great hopes is that we could use that data to then inform how clinicians are treating the patient. And so we can maybe intervene before it becomes too late.
So I've met some of your researchers already. They've got backgrounds in biomedical engineering, health informatics, and mental health and addiction. Why is it important to bring all of these different people together?
Well, you just have to look at the typical heart failure patient. So about 30% have significant mental health issues. About a third have diabetes. Toronto is a multicultural city. And so when you bring a biomedical engineer in whose area of expertise is in looking at light and how light is transduced and changing wearables so that it works regardless of skin tone, that's a tremendous tool in a place like Toronto. When you add a program that is there for management and you enable mental health in the program, or you add diabetes into the program, we're now starting to more holistically look at the patient. We have to be creating and integrating technology and data that actually is available to everyone. And that's how I think we're going to change patients' lives.